first is freedom of speech and expression everywhere in the world. The second is freedom of every person to worship God in his own way everywhere in the world. The third is freedom from want, which translated into world terms means economic understandings which will secure to every nation a healthy peacetime life for its inhabitants everywhere in the world. The fourth is freedom from fear, which translated into world terms means a worldwide reduction of armaments to such a point and in such a thorough fashion that no nation will be in a position to commit an act of physical aggression against any neighbor anywhere in the world. This nation has placed its destiny in the hands and heads and hearts of its millions of free men and women, and its faith in freedom under the guidance of God. Freedom means the supremacy of human rights everywhere. Our support goes to those who struggle to gain those rights and keep them. Our strength is our unity of purpose. To that high concept, there can be no end. Save victory.
Task is today is to convince you folks that God does not exist. Came this gasp from the crowd. What are you talking about? What kind of game are you playing with? I'm not playing. So the worst thing that we could ever happen to us is to discover that God exists.
And if you say that historical evidence doesn't count, then I think you get into huge trouble, because then how do you, I mean, then why not just deny the Holocaust? Or, you know, why not deny that Abraham Lincoln lived? Or why not deny, I mean, just deny, I think these things, you know, I think it matters what happened in history.
It is just a simple observational fact that laws of classical probability theory fall at the quantum level. In the microphysical world, the laws of logic, as we know them, do not hold. This is a fact. This is a scientific fact, an observation.
There is no energy in the universe. Nothing did indeed come from nothing. Science shows that the universe is in fact a big confidence trick. There is truly nothing here.
Our model says this world may not even exist.
Yeah?
That's not a consistent model. You don't live your life by that model.
Yeah, I do.
You live as if this world doesn't exist.
It's necessary.
So you live as if this world may not even exist.
Yeah.
Does that not sound really, really weird to you? Because I guarantee you, when you're eating food, you're not going, you know what? This thing may not even exist, but I'm going to eat it anyway.
You assumed that the universe exists.
How do you know I've even assumed that?
Well, we're talking about your...
You don't even know that we're talking right now.
We've covered this one as well.
I know, and it's inconsistent for you to be arguing with me when you're saying we might not exist.
It's now down to you. It's now down to you to actually demonstrate that there's actually a universe.
What we are, what each of us is, what you are, what I am, is approximately 100 trillion little cellular robots. Not a single one of those cells is conscious. Not a single one of those cells knows who you are or cares. Not so different, really, from a bacterium, each one of them. Consciousness is a bag of tricks.
If I were to give a prize for the single best idea anybody ever had, I'd give it to Darwin for the idea of natural selection. Ahead of Newton, ahead of Einstein, he understood that what he was proposing was a truly revolutionary idea.
But instead, it only came around, as far as I could tell, from about the 1930s or so. Well, okay, that can't be it. In fact, it comes from around 1935, which was the centenary of Darwin's visit to the Galapagos. What was not made was a connection between Darwin's visit to the Galapagos and discovering evolution. Nobody had done that before. But somebody made a little fudge here at the announcement of the meeting of the British Association for the Advancement of Science in 1935, and this is from the Times. And from this newspaper alone, it was reproduced in hundreds of other newspapers and magazines around the world. And from there, on and on it went. So by the mid-20th century, the myth that this great event had happened in the Galapagos was really solidifying, and you begin to find it the next big legend or myth, which is Darwin's delay. Darwin comes up with this theory in the 1830s, the late 1830s. He doesn't publish it until 1858 or 1859. Now, there's a gap between those two dates of 20 years. Now, in recent decades, it's been very widely believed, almost universally believed, that this gap existed because Darwin was afraid to tell people what he believed, that he held it back, that he concealed it, that he kept it a secret. What did Darwin tell his readers? He says on the first page, after I came home from the voyage of the Beagle, in 1837, I began working on this subject. And from that period to the present day, I have steadily pursued the same object. The other problem with the secrecy view is that if you actually do troll through all of Darwin's correspondence, looking for evidence of people who were told by Charles Darwin that he believed in evolution, you can put together quite a long list. I'm putting one together. This list, about 50 people, includes most of his family, friends, and scientific colleagues. The nail in the coffin, the secret view, is in The Origin of Species itself, in the sixth and last edition, published in 1872. This is it. Darwin is trying to defend himself from the claim that, oh, you're always exaggerating your originality. Everyone believes in evolution nowadays. It's not such a big deal. It wasn't so new. And Darwin wants to defend himself from that. He wants to say, oh, yes, it was. It was quite new when I published in 1859. And this is his evidence for it. In those years before I published, I formally spoke to very many naturalists on the subject of evolution and never once met with any sympathetic agreement. Furthermore, there was a convention in Darwin's day that if something was a secret, was to remain private, couldn't be told to anyone else, and couldn't be published, you would mark the letter private. Darwin does that plenty of times, as do many people of his time. But none of the letters that talk about his belief in evolution in the gap period are marked private.
Throughout this series, the existence of the Hegelian dialectic has been demonstrated hiding behind the religious right and atheist left in America and Western Europe. While it appears to the public, there is a dynamic conflict taking place between atheism and theism. Behind these public machinations are a singular endgame and objective, which in reality, is no more acceptable to the vast public actually comprising the rank and file of either the religious right or atheist left people. Both the atheist left and the religious right actually share the belief in the non-existence of God, as a result of medieval Epicurean foundations in Rome's Latin theology, which is being promoted today by the planners of the New World Order. All of which is part of the establishment and institutionalization of Hitler's Third Reich, also known historically as the restoration of the papacy's Holy Roman Empire, or a global Vatican state created by Jesuit counter-reformationists. This two-pronged political deception, or as referred to in political science, as the Hegelian dialectic, is most exposed in both groups by their illogical endorsement of the most sacred and politically important social ritual of the Roman Empire in Western culture, that being Rome's solar mass to Apollyon, as referred to in Revelation chapter 9 verse 11. As you have seen in earlier videos in this series, the Vatican's New World Order has no place for any legal mechanism that would separate the papacy from the control of national governments, thereby protecting secular citizenship from its dictatorial control. And naturally, this includes even the United States, despite the First Amendment clause of its Constitution. Logically, both American atheists and American evangelicals should be in total agreement and among the most rabid fans of the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. For evangelicals, this amendment was the product of the work of Protestant reformers in Europe and in colonial America, who worked tirelessly to bring this about in society, some even paying for this freedom with their own lives, as seen in the martyrdom of Thomas Helways, one of the founders of the Baptist movement in England who was executed by King James. It was a long-fought freedom paid for in blood, that was considered a governmental and political victory over the rule of the Antichrist in Europe, and a gift of freedom for all Americans. It guaranteed no American would ever have to suffer again under the pain of inquisition, imprisonment, torture or even execution by the state over religious belief, or lack thereof, and thereby benefiting everyone who was an American, no matter what their religion would, or would not be. This political arrangement was seen by the founding fathers of the United States government and its people, 70% of whom were Puritan in their theology, as mutually benefiting both the purity and practice of religious piety, and policies of equitable justice concerning the secular matters of the state. As this ideal spread throughout the world, religious and intellectual freedom would be gained, benefiting everyone in civilization, no matter what their religious beliefs happened to be. Thus allowing pursuit of the greatest freedom of thought and expression in every field, from science, to art, to culture, and yes, even to religion. In this video, you will see once again, that the endgame of the Hegelian religious right and atheist left is identical, despite the public deception of antithesis. And that both share the same desire for fascist authoritarianism under the auspices of a global Vatican state. a Vatican state which is granted the right to dictate details of every thought a person might have, be it scientific, religious, or philosophical, even in the privacy of their own home, in complete violation of the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, and in further violation of every ideal of modern Western secular democracy, pioneered by the early proto-Protestant reformer, Girolamo Savonarola in the establishment of the Florentine Republic. The same Florentine Republic and Savonarola, the Roman poet Lucretius and his Epicurean atheism, was revived by the Vatican, to effectively end the ideal of a quote, Christian country end quote, has already been created in history by the English Puritans, who fought an entire revolution in England to establish the separation of church and state, later overturned by the English monarch, and who later carried their idea of an ideal Christian country to America, and worked to establish a secular state in which the separation of church and state was one of its absolute foundational legal principles. And one of their primary concerns historically, was compulsory governmental enforcement of Christmas on private citizens. Both groups, logically should and do, both in reality and in history, have an identical political interest in maintaining the separation of church and state, and the prosperity of free Western democracies. But the Vatican has been very savvy in its political manipulation of the West, using the Hegelian dialectic to divide and conquer what should in fact be a natural political alliance against a single threat, seducing leaders from each side into thinking that it will be their group or ideology that will enjoy dominance in the New World Order. When the truth is, neither will. As Leonardo da Vinci's drawing of the Vesuvian Man illustrates, it will be the papacy of Rome, in the role of an absolute political, religious, and scientific authoritarian dictatorship. An absolute authoritarianism that will do nothing but return the world to some of its darkest chapters of human history.
He gave his life, what more could he give? And oh, how he loves you, and oh, how he loves me, and oh, how he loves you and me.
What a great chorus, why don't you sing it with me?
If you can explain this as a bag of tricks, then it's and not real consciousness.
Oh, how he loves you and me.
Since Martin said, and as other people have said, consciousness is a bag
of tricks. How he loves you and me. He gave his life, what more could he give? And oh, how he loves you, and oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Well, I think somebody needed to hear that song today. So we're going to sing it through one more time. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Their eyes
he gave his life, what more could he give?
When I go to an academic and
But that's
I really am who I am.
That's and in fact the same tradition, just with a mirror in front of it. That's
I really am who I am.
That's and in fact the same tradition, just with a mirror in front of it. That's
I really am who I am.
That's and in fact the same tradition, just with a mirror in front of it. That's
I really am who I am.
That's and in fact the same tradition, just with a mirror in front of it. It's still a sort of creating a fetish around the word. But we did take them to church so that they could hear the music and learn the songs, and we love Christmas, and we have a Christmas carol party that we've had for 25 years, and all our friends come and we all sing the music.
You're hearing it all the time on the news, the separation of church and state. And it is being used by secularists and anti-Christians to try to ban Christmas from the public schools. To ban Christmas trees from public squares. To ban nativity scenes. To keep students from wearing crosses or carrying their Bibles in school. We must have the separation of church and state. Not in the American Constitution.
What about your grandchildren? Do you want them to be raised in a traditional?
Yes, I'd like them to know the tradition. I have a grandson, and we've talked about this. He's not, in fact, going to Sunday school now, but that would be fine if he did. My one bronze piece that I have is called Three People in the Cathedral, and that's the very point of it, is to show how going in the cathedral just exalts you, and the three people have sort of taken on this, you would say, transcendent attitude from their presence in this amazing building. I am a lover of cathedrals, and I feel their power. It helps to be steeped in the traditions of the cathedral, to be able to look up and to tell which saint that is up there in that niche, and which story is being illustrated in this panel, and to recognize the music and to know its roots. I think that knowing the lore, the traditions, the history of Christianity, it's the only religion I know well, I couldn't understand it without steeping myself in that lore a lot. Whatever it is that created all this wonderful life. Well, in that case, I believe in God because I believe in evolution. Anselm notoriously, famously, defined God
as the
being greater than which nothing can be conceived. It's a very hard phrase to get your head around. The most perfect, imaginable being. Well, now, is the universe itself the being greater than which nothing can be conceived? Well, it's greater than I can conceive. It's greater than any one person, scientist or cosmologist or philosopher, can conceive. If that's what God is, then I believe in it. Even if you're right that what's good for General Motors is good for the country, we want to know, what would you do if push came to shove? What if in some instance, some policy you had to decide as Secretary of Defense, you could see that what was good for the country wasn't necessarily good for General Motors? Then where would your first priority be? They wanted to make sure that his priority was what's good for the country, not what's good for General Motors. And they required him to put his holdings in a blind trust and all the rest of that. Now, imagine a politician today saying, well, what I've always believed is what's good for the Baptist Church is good for the country. don't think we should stand for that. I think we should make the same human cry. We should say, hang on, we don't mind you having your priorities that way, but if that's what your priorities are, I think we want somebody else to be in office, because we want people that we have in office to put the preservation of the democracy, the preservation of the separation of church and states. Preservation of our secular democracy ahead of their religion.
You know, there are a lot of people who would say amen to that. No pun intended. They would say amen. Yeah. They would believe with you. No matter what their strong opinions they about their own faith, they would agree with that.
Absolutely, but, right. But
if you were talking here, in effect, about how democracy in the, how we as a nation in the early days made an agreement to avoid absolutes. We said we're going to put absolutes off the table when it comes to questions of religion. That's what some people call the separation of church and state. It was that we will not organize our politics around a battle for absolutes. Do you see that in danger today?
Yeah, I do indeed. I think we're living in a time where it's time for people really to stand up and be counted and make very clear where they stand on the separation of church and state.
Yes.
I think the big problem that we have is we have been too willing just to let people play the faith card, and it just trumps everything. And it might have been all right, except it's being abused a great deal around the world today. We have been too willing just to let people play the faith card, and it just trumps everything. And it might have been all right, except it's being abused a great deal around the world today.
And so we need to realize that today, because we are being attacked and bombarded on all kinds of fronts.
Besides, nobody believes that. Let's face it. If somebody came up and said, look, my religion says I don't have to make up a case. I'm going to take the case of apostasy you just mentioned. There are clerics in Islam right now who say, death for apostasy, that's our religion, and we should do it. Been too willing just to let people play the faith card, and it just trumps everything. And it might have been all right, except it's being abused a great deal around the world today. And there are clerics in Islam right now who say, death for apostasy, that's our religion, and we should do it.
Modern-day Islamism is attempting to bring about the very thing it despises, which is Western Catholicism before the Reformation. I refer to Islamism as the bastard child of colonialism. Frankly, that's what it is. Modern-day Islamism is attempting to bring about the very thing it despises, which is Western Catholicism before the Reformation. Modern-day Islamism is attempting to bring about the very thing it despises, which is Western Catholicism before the Reformation.
What your tradition is, this is not a tradition that should be honored.
Catholic Church once put heretics to
absolutely
the stake.
Absolutely right, and they've learned better, haven't they?
They've learned.
And I think we should not be afraid to say to the Muslim world, come on, wake up. We made this mistake in the past too, we Christians. But we're not making it anymore, because we Jews, that certainly Christians and Jews certainly made that mistake. But we're not making it anymore, because we Jews, that certainly Christians and Jews certainly made that mistake, because we Jews, that certainly Christians and Jews, because we Jews, that certainly Christians and Jews certainly made that mistake in the past. I have one proposal which I think is really important, and that is we should have a national curriculum on world religions that is compulsory for all school children, from grade school through high school, for the public schools, for the private schools, for the homeschooling. And
why?
Because if we taught the young people of a country this, then you could teach them whatever else you wanted.
He also added that there were annual fast days appointed by the government. Those earliest Americans didn't know anything about a separation of faith from government. Now, we hear a lot about the separation of church and state. That statement is not in our Constitution. Not there. That statement, you know, it was in the Soviet Union's constitution. I understand the separation of church and state, but it is not in the American constitution.
And I wouldn't worry about religions that, I think any religion that could flourish under those conditions.
Freedom of every person to worship God in his own way, everywhere.
A valuable, a wonderful religion.
Officers arrive at a Nazi institution seized by First Army troops. Under the guise of an insane asylum, this has been the headquarters for the systematic murder of 35,000 Poles, Russians, and Germans sent here mainly for political and religious considerations. Those still alive are examined by Major Hermann Bolker of the American War Crimes Investigation Team. The townspeople in Hadamar, Germany, called this place the House of Shudders.
And they ask me what I work on, and I say, consciousness. Their eyes don't glaze over. Their lips curl into a snarl. And I get hoots of derision and cackles and growls. The reason for that is that everybody's an expert on consciousness. With regard to consciousness, people seem to think, each of us seems to think, I am an expert. Simply by being conscious, I know all about this. And so you tell them your theory, and they say, no, that's not the way consciousness is. No, you got it all wrong. What we are, what each of us is, what you are, what I am, is approximately 100 trillion little cellular robots. That's what we're made of. No other ingredients at all. We're just made of cells, about 100 trillion of them. Not a single one of those cells is conscious. Not a single one of those cells knows who you are or cares.
Modern technologies of diagnosis and treatment of living cells. Part 1. Bioelectric and bioelectromagnetic fundamental principles of living cells. Abstract. Bioelectric and bioelectromagnetic activities of living cells are based on 5 fundamental principles. 1. Balance of bioelectric and bioelectromagnetic fields in chromosomes. 2. Balance of bioelectric charges in cellular walls. 3. balance of bioelectric and bioelectromagnetic fields in cellular channels. 4. Balance of bioelectromagnetic fields in cellular poles. 5. Battery capacity and cell's capability in energy distribution inside the cell. Keywords: cellular balance, bioelectric, bioelectromagnetic. Introduction. Human beings and the other living organisms are a large collection of individual living cells as their components. Each cell is a fully independent unit, which can solely live forever under optimal conditions. Each cell can also plan and manage all of its vital needs and treat and rebuild disorders caused by internal and external factors. Study and analysis of living organisms that have been made of thousands of billions of cells are possible by studying and analyzing their single cells.
Consciousness is a bag of tricks. This means that a lot of people are just left completely dissatisfied and incredulous when I attempt to explain consciousness. But I'm not going to explain it all to you. I'm going to do what philosophers do. Here's how a philosopher explains the sawing the lady in half trick. You know the sawing the lady in half trick? And the philosopher says, I'm going to explain to you how that's done. You see, the magician doesn't really saw the lady in half. He merely makes you think that he does. And you say, yeah, and how does he do that? He says, oh, that's not my department, I'm sorry. Consciousness isn't quite as marvelous. Your own consciousness isn't quite as wonderful as you may have thought it is. The brain just makes you think that it's got the detail there. You think the detail's there, but it isn't there. The brain isn't actually putting the detail in your head at all, it's just making you expect the detail. You don't know how you do it, you just know that you have certain beliefs. And they come in a certain order at a certain time, and that in fact, you are not the authority on your own consciousness that you think you are.
I think actually the answer to that is quite clear. An instinct that we share with mammals in general is when something that we don't understand happens, when something startling or surprising or worrisome happens, the most natural thing in the world, it's really instinctual, is to go, who's there? Who's there? And what do you want? Not what's that, but who's there? The most natural thing in the world, it's really instinctual, is to go, who's there? Who's there? And what do you want? Not what's that, but who's there? Not what's that, but who's there? Not what's that, but who's there? Why? Because sometimes there's somebody there, and that somebody might want you. So when you're startled, looking for an agent, looking for a being that has beliefs and desires, looking for a being that's conscious, is a very good strategy, even if you have a lot of false alarms. So your dog does it. The snow falls off the roof and lands with a thud outside the window, and your dog jumps up and growls and looks around. That's the very same instinct in the dog that we have. The difference is that in us, it doesn't stop with just looking around and then going back to sleep. It echoes and echoes and echoes. And so we begin to populate our world with imaginary, invisible agents. There, who is there? And that initial population explosion of, that's not religion, that's just superstition. That's goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that. But they are the ancestors in idea space of the few gods and then eventually the monotheistic god. Natural thing in the world, it's really instinctual, is to go, who's there? Who's there? And what do you want? Not what's that, but who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
depths of the Amazon rainforest, a Waldani hunter stalks his prey, as his ancestors have done for hundreds of years. His blowgun poised, a quiver of poison darts close at hand, he gazes into the densely interwoven layer of branches that forms the canopy. 10 stories above the forest floor, an unsuspecting woolly monkey searches for food. The hunter quickly prepares a poison dart while carefully watching his prey above. With deadly accuracy, the final dart pierces the monkey's heart, and soon its struggles cease. Armed with primitive weapons, the Waldani hunter relies on extraordinary skill and cunning to harvest the bounty of the forest. His knowledge of the jungle and its creatures is legendary. His knowledge of the jungle and its creatures is legendary. His knowledge of the jungle and its creatures is legendary.
Say 10, but hold it.
If you don't believe in ghosts, we'll show you something that could change your mind. This is what a woman saw while working at an Oklahoma car impound lot earlier this month. It was all caught on a surveillance tape. You can see the figure circling around. Now, the woman told another worker to go out and check it out.
Max said there wasn't nobody back there. The wind was still that night. Our alarm was on, so nobody jumped the fence back there.
3 vehicles on the lot that night were involved in fatal accidents. A paranormal investigator says it's possible the mysterious figure could have been one of those spirits searching for its car. We'll let you draw your own conclusion.
Kim Peterson was curious, too, when she reviewed security tapes a couple weeks ago and saw that motion sensors kicked cameras into action. And there wasn't any action in the gym.
So I just called my security company and said, you know, is there a light bulb going out? Do I need to get up and clean the lens? And they reviewed it and said, I have no idea what that is.
Security cameras caught a white orb wandering around the gym. The orb hovers and lingers near the dumbbells. It leaves the frame, then comes back and kicked the motion sensors into action a total of 9 times. Between 2 and 4:30 in the morning.
I'm sure there's a logical explanation.
But not one Provision Security has been able to come up with in the last 2 weeks. Reps told us the system is activated by motion, but not just any motion. They say a bug wouldn't turn this model on, or dust. It would take much more than headlights passing by. 600 other clients have the same system. But none of them have ever recorded a mystery.
My 8-year-old said, maybe Grandpa's just making sure you're doing okay in your new business, Mom.
Could be a spirit.
the eerie experience. I had the eerie experience. I had the eerie experience of something speaking to me as if the person knew me. And I think anyone who has any experience of an encounter with the ghost, an encounter with the ghost, an encounter with the ghost, an encounter with the ghosts of the past, knows what I'm talking about, where it seems impossible, and yet it's happening, and yet it's happening, and yet it's happening. Who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
It's goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that. Who's there? Who's there?
Who's there? Walter! Walter!
Goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that.
What are you doing in my house?
Who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
Who's there? Justin? Justin who?
It's goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that.
Knock, knock!
Who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
Who's there?
It's goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that. Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? It's goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that. Who's there? 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 Goblins and leprechauns and elves and things like that. Elves and things like that. Who's there? 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 Who's there?
Who's there?
Who's there?
Who's there? Who's there?
Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there